Is that the signal? All right. Jerry, just let me know. We're live here on our Facebook page, and I want to thank everybody for being here with us tonight. We got a good crowd here tonight in person here in our beautiful sanctuary. I also want to thank you at home who are joining us, like I said, on our church Facebook page. And if you will now join me tonight, let's go once again to the Gospel of John. But this time we're going to pick up in chapter 21. So if you will, take your Bibles, open up to the Gospel of John, chapter 21, and as you're opening up your Bibles, I'm going to, as we should in all things, give this time, give this moment of study to God in prayer. So let's pray. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, once again we are honored and blessed to be here, one with each other, with you. We are joined here in this beautiful sanctuary, those in person, those joining us on Facebook. And I just ask you now, through the same power of your Holy Spirit, the power of your Holy Spirit that brought your word together for us, brought this beautiful gospel into this book for us, let your Holy Spirit also now work within us, opening us up as we prepare in closing out this gospel. So lead us now, dear God, as only you and you alone can do. As once again, we place ourselves in this time of study into your loving, life-giving hands. And we ask all this in your holy, mighty, and very precious name. Amen. All right, so as you remember, we did look at the last part of chapter 20. We finished up with verses 26 through 29 and talked about Jesus giving us his personal description of what faith is, where he's closed out, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." But we also talked about the fact that just because Thomas and the other disciples got their faith by seeing Jesus, it did not make their faith an inferior or lesser faith. We concluded with reminding us how their faith is the foundational faith upon which our faith today is based. And so now we're going to pick up with chapter 21. But in doing this right off the bat, I owe you all an apology. Last week I told you that we were going to skip verses 1 through 14 and just go straight into that great story starting in 15 about where Jesus and Peter and the love for each other. But I also feel like it's my responsibility as the teacher of this and leader to just double check everything. So I started reading the passage here and I started looking through my books, and suddenly about four different things popped out to me. It's like, wait a minute, we got to talk about this. So, I am going to look at verses 1 through 14 tonight with the plan to finish up then next week. So, if you will join me now beginning at verse 1 of chapter 21. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. All right, so as we see now, John takes us to the Sea of Tiberias, and it's located in Galilee. Now, right off the bat, we must understand here that the disciples, they don't end up in Galilee by their own choice. This wasn't their decision. To understand what's going on, this is one of those times we have to depend upon the other Gospels. Now, in Matthew chapter 28, verse 10, along with Mark chapter 16, verse 17, we read there in the resurrection story how the women, remember, the women are the ones that show up. And in both instances there in Matthew and Mark, Jesus is telling these women, go and tell the disciples, they should go now and meet me in Galilee. Or like Matthew chapter 28, verse 10, the last part, Jesus says, there they will see me. And so Jesus calls them to now go to Galilee. And there they're staying. They're in Galilee. And they stay in Galilee until the time when Pentecost is drawing near. You know, that's the 50 days after his resurrection. That's when Jesus is going to send them back to Jerusalem so that they can then receive the coming of the Holy Spirit. But until then, that's where they are staying. Now, while they're there, look at verses 2 and 3. So they're waiting to hear from Jesus again. And we read, Peter says to the other disciples, what's he now going to do? I'm going fishing. Now, the truth is this. No fishing trip has ever been so severely judged and condemned as this fishing trip has ever been. There are people that don't like the fact that at this point, the disciples decide to go fishing. Many people, many scholars have criticized Peter and the other disciples for doing this. Some have called it what they say is an apostasy. Or in other words, they've abandoned everything that Jesus has taught them. Other people call it nothing more than an act of desperation. Or simply put, everybody seems to believe this, that at this point, the disciples are now supposed to be going off, signing up to attend whatever seminary they want to go to so that they can begin their studies on the New Testament. Which couldn't happen because the New Testament hadn't even been written or put together yet. But everybody thinks, oh, they're supposed to be studying and getting ready. But the real truth is this. Should we be condemning or judging the disciples for doing this? So should we? What is your opinion? Should we judge them for going fishing at this point? Well, the truth, no, you're right. The truth is no. There's nothing wrong, actually. There's nothing wrong with Peter and the other disciples making the decision to go fishing that night. Why is it not a problem? Well, let's talk about a few things. Well, first off, they're once again, they're in Galilee, they're at the Sea of Tiberias, and they're there because Jesus commanded them to do so. And from what we can gather, there's been some time, a few days have passed since they last saw or talked to Jesus. And as they're around, when you're a fisherman, what's the best way for you to spend your time doing? If you're a fisherman, what's the best way for you to spend your time? Fishing. Yes, right. Going fishing. All right? And so that's what they do. They go fishing. Because what we have to realize is this. You know, Peter is not saying, he's not making some grand announcement like, well, I'm finished with preaching, okay? I'm finished with dealing with Jesus. I'm finished with the kingdom of God. I'm going to go back to what I used to do. I'm going to go back to my old line of work, which is fishing. That is not what Peter is saying here, okay? They're just simply biding their time. But there's also another reason why they should go fishing. What do you think would also, though, be the basic human need and reason? You know, other than the fact that fishermen have got to fish, what would also be another basic human need that they would need to take care of during this time?
They're hungry.
They've got to eat. Disciples have got to eat. And they can either eat that fish or they can do what? Take it to the market and sell it and get money to provide, you know, for themselves because they're just sitting around right now. All right? But the big thing is what you should understand about them doing this is actually something else. There's something else that should stand out. What does this moment truly do reveal to us concerning Peter? Look at verse 3. What is the one thing that's missing there in verse 3? You know, he says, I'm going fishing, and we read, they said to him, we will go with you. They went out and got into the boat. What's missing? The other six disciples, they did not do what? Huh? Well, no, they go with him. They all go. You know, they said to him, we will go with you. What's missing is the fact there's no questions. They don't debate Peter. Well, Peter, we really shouldn't do this. There's no response other than the fact, we'll go with you, which just simply reminds us what? Once again, of Peter's what within the disciples? His what?
He's the head.
He's the head, his leadership. That he is still, in spite of everything that's gone on with Peter, the denial, all the other stuff that's been happening, Peter is still considered to be their leader. And what Peter says goes. And so to me, it's a wonderful reminder, you know, not something we should judge or condemn. It's a wonderful reminder. Jesus is still the leader. He's still the big fisherman in all of this. Well, then look at verses 4 and 5. Now, in verse 4, we read now that it's just after daybreak. Jesus appears on the shore of the beach, and we are told what happens then. What happens in verse 4? Or what does not happen? Okay, they don't recognize him. They do not know it's Jesus. Now, once again, there's a lot of scholars that want to read more into this than I think is really there. Many scholars, they talk about the fact that the reason why they didn't recognize Jesus was for two different reasons. First off, they believe that their eyes were closed just like who? Remember the story in Luke? What two disciples? They're on the road to what? Do you remember? Emmaus. On the road to Emmaus. And we're told that God closed their eyes so that they couldn't see that it was Jesus, okay? So some people like to say that that's also what happened to them. But for a lot of people, this is a reference to what they like to call the mystery of Jesus' resurrected body. People want to point out, they want to say things like that. You know, Jesus not only as he did that first night, that Easter evening. Remember how they were in the locked house and suddenly appeared? They want to talk about the fact that not only can he appear any place he wants to, but other than that, he can also appear in any form. He can appear in any way, any appearance that he wants to appear. Well, I've got a problem with that, I'll be honest with you. With that type of thinking about Jesus in this resurrected body. You see, for me, the question has always been, why would Jesus ever want to hide or conceal his identity, especially from his disciples? You know, I mean, one of the reasons why Jesus was raised from the dead was to show the world that he is the one true living Lord and Savior. Why would he want to hide his identity, especially from his disciples at the moment when they need to see him the most? When they need to have their faith strengthened? When they need to hear from Jesus himself? So for me, it's never been any type of mystery. It's not like he can make himself appear to be somebody else. Because I don't think Jesus would ever deliberately try and hide his identity, especially from them. Now for me, there's something else here. For us to understand what's going on, why they don't recognize Jesus, let's take a moment and think about the circumstances that are surrounding the event. First, when was it that the disciples went fishing? John tells us they went fishing when in verse 3? At night. Now, and that was typical, okay? You normally went fishing at nighttime, okay? Now, second, what time of day does Jesus appear to the disciples? There in verse 4. In the morning. Mine says just after daybreak. Anybody got anything different?
At dawn.
At dawn, okay. Morning time. Early morning, dawn, daybreak, anything like that. So let's think about it for a moment. You know, under these conditions, what could then actually be some real reasons why they don't recognize Jesus at the moment? Well, first off, since once again it's early morning, isn't it possible they've been out all night in the dark and suddenly the sun's coming up? What happens to your eyes? You have trouble doing what?
Focusing.
Yeah, focusing. Adjusting your eyes. How many times have you been someplace dark and then you walk out into the night or the light and bang, it's hard to adjust, hard to focus. I could see that happening. Maybe the sun was in their eyes. You know, Jesus is going to return from the east. I think he likes coming from the east. Maybe the sun was behind Jesus and they couldn't see him. With it being early morning right there on the Sea of Tiberias, what is also a possibility of something rolling in off the water at that time? Fog or some type of mist could have actually been there. But John also, though, gives us a very legitimate reason there in verse 8 as to why they might not recognize Jesus.
He's a football field away.
He's a football field away, which was typical. Normally, you went out around 100 yards to do your fishing. I don't know about you, but I've stood at one end of a football field, and sometimes it's hard to recognize, especially if it's just the sun's just coming up. You're trying to get your eyes focused, okay? So the thing is, there's some very legitimate reasons. We don't have to try and come up with, well, God blinded them, or, you know, God prevented it, or simply he just changed his looks. I think there's some very legitimate reasons here. But let's go into verse 5. Because to me, this is where it really gets interesting. Because in verse 5, we read how Jesus did ask the disciples a very specific question. Now, the New Revised Standard I read from, it has this question that Jesus asked. Children, you have no fish, have you? Now, what else have you got in verse 5 as far as the question that Jesus asked?
Have you any meat?
Have you any food? Well, that's a different way, okay.
Have you any meat?
Okay. Is there anything that shows that you have no fish? Have you? Did it say you have no meat? Have you? Was there anything like that?
Have you got any fish?
Have you got any fish? Well, the thing is, in the Greek Testament, okay, in the Greek manuscript, what it is, it's more along that line. Children, you have no fish, have you? Or you have caught no fish, haven't you? Kind of along that line. To show in what? When you hear it that way, from the question, Jesus already knows what then?
The answer.
He already knows the answer to the question. He knows. He's not guessing. He's not taking a chance. Jesus already knows that they have no fish. Okay? Which then brings us to verses 6 and 7. As a result then of listening to Jesus, they throw the net to the other side, and what happens?
Catch so many fish, they can't raise the net.
All right, they catch them up. They can't even bring the net up into the boat. But then, more importantly, in verse 7, what happens?
They know it's Jesus.
Well, not they. Who knows? Who's the first to recognize it?
John.
The beloved, you know, the one that Jesus loved, says, it is the Lord. Now, the question becomes this. What is it that suddenly helped the beloved disciple to know that this stranger was Jesus? What do you think suddenly makes the difference that John can now recognize Jesus? Is it the sun is now up higher and that he can get a better look at him? Or what do you think might have been? What was it that caused John to know that this was Jesus? What do you think could have been? Very good, very good. If you were to go to Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, Luke tells a story about it's early morning. The fishermen have already come in and they're cleaning their nets. Jesus goes and he's standing in a boat there right off into the water and he's preaching. And then he turns to Peter and he tells Peter to cast his net out into the water. Peter and the other fishermen who were there with him at the time, and if you get into the story, you discover that James and his brother John, sons of Zebedee, they're there. They're working with Peter. Peter says, Master, we have been fishing all night and couldn't catch any fish. Jesus says, do it anyway. Peter cast out the net, and there's so many fish that they have to bring in other boats to help get the fish into it, So the thing is, John has experienced this once before. He knows in his heart then, doesn't he? He knows that at this moment, you know, this is Jesus. But there's something even greater that happens at that moment. What follows with that when he says, it is the Lord? What's the thing that follows up the most in that verse? At the moment Peter hears this, what happens?
Put it on his coat and jumps in the water.
Okay, you got to put it on his coat. How many of you got to put some clothes on? Got to put clothes on or put a robe on, put a coat. And the reason why he does it is because he's what?
Naked,
all right? Now, what do you think is the number one question that gets asked at this point in the story? What do you think is the number one question?
Why is he naked?
Why? Okay, well, kind of like in the same way. The number one question is, just how naked was Peter before he put his clothes on? Just how naked is he? Now, to find out the answer to this, we have to take a look at the two options that the Greek manuscript that John has written here gives us two possibilities. Now, first off, if you choose to interpret the Greek one way, you discover that Peter has taken just off his tunic. A tunic was a knee-length undershirt, okay? Remember, picture Jesus. Remember how he walked? He had that long robe, a lot of times just below the knee. They had the sandals on, but he would then also have on what? An outer robe, okay? What they believe is, according to the first one, is that he's just taken off that undershirt, the knee-length undershirt. He's still wearing the outer robe, okay? But before he jumps into the water, Peter takes that tunic. He doesn't put it on, but instead he wraps it around him like a sash and tucks it into his loincloth, okay? And then goes in. There's a second interpretation, that Peter has actually taken both this outer robe and that inner tunic off, leaving him with nothing on but his loincloth. And before he jumps into the water, Peter takes that outer robe of his and puts it on himself, okay? It's just an outer robe that he would have been wearing, okay? And he wraps it, the bottom part, around, tucking it in his loincloth. And he does that for what reason? Because so that he can leave what free when he's trying to swim? Either way you interpret it, whether it's a tunic or the outer robe, he's still tucking it in because he wants to keep what free so he can swim? His legs. His legs and his hands. You know, he wants to keep his legs free. But it's not the fact. This is where another reason why I wanted to bring this out. It's not the fact that Peter does either of these things that should be the focus of what and why Peter does all this at the moment. You see, with this action, Peter is demonstrating what two very specific feelings that he has concerning Jesus. There are two feelings that he has for Jesus at this moment. First, we're witnessing, what do you think, Peter's strong what? What do you think could be the first feeling that he has? It's a feeling of what for Jesus?
That longing or love.
A love. There's a feeling of love here that, you know, Peter's love for Jesus calls him to he can't stop, to swim to Jesus immediately, okay? But the thing is, what does a person normally wear when they swim in the water? Basically, they don't have what? Much clothing on at all right? So, you know, we have swims. People, you know, young people wear the swimsuits today. I don't swim anymore, but, you know, wear swimsuits and things like that. But most of the time, you don't have very much clothes on when you're swimming. But Peter loves Jesus still so much, he just is compelled to get to him as quick as he can. But secondly, with his actions, by making sure that he puts something on, he is also showing great what toward Jesus. Okay, not just love. Love is the first one.
I would say respect.
Respect. First, there's love. You're right. You're right, Mr. Dave. Love is the first one. But there's a respect. You know, by covering himself with an outer garment, Peter is showing a deep respect for Jesus. Peter has such great respect for Jesus that he could not bring himself to come to Jesus in any way that would show disrespect to him, okay? And this was important. is important because, see, for Jewish people back in this time, to greet someone in the proper way, it was not just a sign of respect, it was also considered to be a religious act. Even, you know, especially for someone who would be considered a what? What would Jesus have been? You know,
a Jew?
Well, not just a Jew, but a Jewish what? Religious leader. A rabbi. A teacher, you know? Thing is, they know Jesus is more than that personally now. They know that he is the Messiah. But even as a rabbi, remember several times they referred to him up to that point as rabbi, teacher, master. It would have been a religious act almost to come to him in a respectful way, all right? So G. Peter is showing great love. He's showing great respect. The question now becomes, which feeling for Jesus is Peter going to give into? And the answer is obviously what? He's going to give in to which one?
Love.
Well, not just love, but he actually gives in to both of them, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah.
He gives in to both feelings. He's going to swim to Jesus as quickly as he can because of his love for Jesus. It compels Peter to get to him. But at the same time, he's going to do what? He's showing great respect to Jesus, but not showing up what would have been considered naked by only wearing nothing but a loincloth. Okay? It's a wonderful example of how we should always come to Jesus ourselves. Yes, ma'am. What's the question?
I was just wondering how well the loincloths were made. I mean, if you got one wet, would it stay on?
I don't know. That's a good question. I wish I had a better answer for it. I don't know how well they'd stay on. Apparently, they held on pretty good. That's what Jesus, all he had on, what we know of when he was crucified. And, you know, he's held that. So
it's probably a rope.
Probably get on with you some type of rope, maybe. I'm sure it had to be some type of rope, a leather piece. Or, well, but they would have leather pieces. Yeah, they had belts and stuff. Their part of a belt was also on the Roman uniform as well. So, but see, I like this for the simple fact that it reminds us this is how we should also come to Jesus. We need to come to Jesus always because of our great love, knowing that we are always welcomed by Jesus. Jesus loves us so much that he always welcomes us to come to him. But when we come to him, we don't need to come in some haphazard way, do we? Jesus has earned the respect that we should give to him as our Lord, as our Savior, as the Messiah, as God's Son. We shouldn't come to him and just, oh, hey, Jesus, what, you know, type stuff. We shouldn't come to him with some lack of respect. We need to come with him with true respect. Honoring Jesus for who he is, but more importantly, for what he has done for us. That's what Peter is doing. He's showing love and he's showing respect. And he's teaching us we can do the same thing. To come to Jesus with love and come to him out of respect. And then look at the last part, verses 9 through 14. This really gets us now into what I really wanted to share with y'all in this section. Now, once again, remember, when it comes to understanding the Gospel of John, what is the one thing that I've told you over and over that you have to do as you're reading John? There's one very specific thing that I've said you always need to do. You have to ask what question?
Why?
Why what?
Why
did he say what he said? Why did John choose to write that specific thing, okay? Remember, it's something that you do all through John. Because John loves to put little tidbits into his gospel. He loves to put these little hidden things that you and I can take the time to really discover. Now, in verses 9 through 14, I could probably pick out four. But there are two very specific things. Two very specific things that John makes sure to point out. Or to tell us about. Now, when you're looking at these, you might want to think that first off, it could be verse 9, where, you know, they come up, Jesus already has the charcoal fire with some fish on it, and why would Jesus then tell Peter, bring some more fish when he's already got some fish? But that's kind of an obvious thing. First off, he's got a number of people he's got to feed. He was just getting things started, maybe. But it's also a beautiful reminder that no matter if Jesus catches the fish, or we catch the fish, who owns the fish? Jesus does. They're all still Jesus, okay? But I found two very specific things in one verse. Look at the first part of verse 11. What do you think is something very specific that John didn't have to say in the first part of verse 11 that we should take notice of? The very first part of verse 11. Okay, but a little bit deep, a little bit more. Look at it a little bit deeper. What specific thing does John point out in the first part of verse 11?
Peter went back and helped.
No, I'm to something else, a little bit deeper than that. Go deeper, folks.
150.
Why in the world does John take the time to point out that there were 153 fish? Why not say a large number of fish? He could have even said there were over 100 fish. But here he does what? He specifically gives us a number. A specific number. 153. Why is John telling us this? Well, I'm going to be telling us with you. There are three possible answers as to where this 153 comes from. The first one is given to us by a man known as Cyril of Alexandria. Cyril of Alexandria, he is a theologian, a scholar, but more importantly, he is the patriarch and bishop of the Church of Alexandria. If you ever watched Indiana Jones, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark, they talk about Alexandria, okay? The thing is, the Church of Alexandria, and he says that the number 153 comes to us from three specific ways or three different things. First off, the number 100, according to Cyril of Alexandria, is a complete number that represents the fullness of the coming of the Gentiles to the gospel message. Now, in Matthew chapter 18, what is the total number of sheep once the shepherd goes out and finds the sheep that is lost, brings it back, and how many sheep does he now have? He has 100. 99 are there, one is lost. He goes and brings it back, so he has a total of what? 100 sheep. Also, when Jesus tells about the parable of the seeds, where the sower throws the seeds out among the rocky soil, there are the thorns, but then he throws the seeds among the fertile soil, how much comes back? How much does the seed produce? Do you remember? 100-fold. It produces 100-fold, okay? This is a reference to the Gentiles. So Cyril says, first off, 100 represents the Gentiles. He then says the number 50 represents the remnant of Israel. The remnant of Israel that's going to be gathered in. And he gets this from the book of Isaiah chapter 10, verses 20 and 22. This is where a remnant of Israel is going to survive the invasion of the Assyrian army, okay? And the remnant that is left, they have been given the promise that one day they will be taken back to the promised land by who? Who's going to bring them back to the promised land?
Moses.
Huh?
Moses.
No, not Moses. This is after that. This occurs after Moses. Who's going to return them back to the promised land? Yahweh. God is. God is going to bring them back one day. Moses gets them there, you know, to the first time. This is after return to the promised land. And then, of course, the number three, what do you think the number three would represent?
Trinity.
The Trinity, okay? The Trinity is how all things are brought about and they are completed. So according to him, 100 is for the God, is for the Gentiles, 50 for the Israelites, and 3 represents the Trinity that's going to bring it all together. Now, to be honest with you, this is a very ingenious and interesting explanation, but there's no truth behind it. Okay. We really have nothing that backs it up, but it's a good way of looking at it. So let's look at the second one. Now, this is from St. Augustine. Now, he tells us that the number 153 comes from a combination of two different numbers. First off, there's the number 10, which is the number of the law. And the number of the law of 10 is based on what, do you think? What do we associate with the law? What number 10? The 10 what? The 10 commandments. Okay, so we get that. The number 7 is the number of grace, which is based on the gifts of grace given to us by the Holy Spirit, which is how many gifts? I take a guess. You got 10 and then what? 7? There's sevenfold. It's 7 gifts, okay? You add 10 and 7, you get what? 17. Now, 17, according to St. Augustine, is the foundation number for the triangular number 153. 153 is known as a triangular number, okay? The thing is, the sum of all the numbers from 1 to 17, if you add them, you say 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 and continue on all the way to then plus 17, what total do you get? 153. Now, Dr. Joe, in his book, he talks about it like this. He described it as a triangle formed by different rows of marbles. The bottom row is 17, the next is 16, the next is 15, all the way up to 1, okay? And this being a triangular number, once again, would refer to what? What's triangular?
Trinity.
The Trinity, okay? But once again, there's not much that supports this either, okay? Which brings us to a third possibility. St. Jerome tells us this. He gives us what we say is the simplest explanation of all. According to St. Jerome, there are how many different kinds of fish in the Sea of Tiberias? How many do you think? According to St. Jerome, what's the number of different kinds of fish?
153.
That's what he says, okay? He says that the catch of 153, they include all the fish in the sea, which also means what? That one day, who's going to be gathered in front of Jesus? That all people, all men and women of all nations will one day be gathered to stand before Jesus. Very simple, very, you know, ingenious, I believe, excellent explanation. But once again, there's nothing. The truth is this, y'all. We don't know what that 153 stands for.
Possibly they could have caught 153 fish.
Possibly could have caught 153 fish. But for John, it means something. So that means what? We simply got to wait till we get to heaven, we hunt John down, and we ask him, why 153 fish? John doesn't do anything by accident. He has a reason behind it. We just don't know why. But I thought it was interesting just to talk about it and everything.
Maybe 152 is the limit for not breaking the net.
Oh, 153. I mean, 153 it might have been the limit. I don't know. That's a good thought.
Or maybe it's like 100. Broken at one time, but they got 150.
They got 150. It could be a number of different things. It's important to John. We just don't know why it's important to him. Now look at the last part of verse 11, where we find then the other specific thing that he makes sure that we know. What's in the last part? All right, they're very good. There, you know, so many, the net was not torn. Now see, if you check this out, you can skip all this. You can read all this and not have to include it. But once again, he does this. 153, and then so many, the net was not torn. Now, the reason why we question it, first off, we've already talked about this in verse 6. Remember, he's already talked about the fact that there were so many fish in the net that they couldn't even get it in the boat, which is also a reference to it not being torn. But there's two possible ways, once again, to look at this. And these are very legitimate, okay? First off, the net can stand for what group of people? What organization? The net can stand for who? For what, I should say. How about the
group of disciples, maybe?
No, how about, where are we? Where are we right now?
The church.
The church. What if the net stands for the church? That means what? That there is room in the church for who? For everyone. Isn't that a beautiful way of looking? There's, you know, the thing is, the church should be known as always being big enough to hold everyone who comes to Christ. But for us to understand that, we have to also realize that the church is not a what? The church can never truly be a what? A building. The church is not a building. The church is us. The church lives within our hearts, and we should be open to everybody. Isn't that a beautiful way of looking at that? It's the fact that, yes, the church is open to everyone. We should know when Jesus says, love everyone as I have loved you. You know, forgive one another as I have forgiven you. That's part of what the church does. A building cannot do that for us. You know, only we can do that for each other. But there's also a second very good part, that the strength of the net to hold all the fish could also represent the strength and the success of what other thing that we have that's been given to us. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John also gave us what? They have given us the what? What kind of message? What message?
Salvation.
Okay, message. But more importantly, put it all together. All four of them are considered the what? Of what? They're the what of Christ? The Gospels. This could also represent the complete gospel message. The message of the gospel is a message of love, salvation, and grace. But it's a message that's open to who?
Everyone.
It's a message open to everyone. But more importantly, it's a message that the world cannot want, cannot overcome. It's a message that the world cannot stop. But more importantly, it's a message that when it lives inside you, what gives you the strength to always what? Hold on. To not break. But to always stand strong for Jesus. To hold on. That's the gospel message. To know that we have a Lord and a Savior who's living, who defeated death, who there for us constantly, giving us the strength to go forth and do what we are now called to do, which is to all be ministers in one way or another. That's the call of the gospel for each and every one of us. But in concluding all this, the main reason why I want us to look at verses 1 through 10, because it also gives us one main message. A message that you and I, we need to receive in our lives each and every day. What do you think is the main overall message in verses 1 through 14? What do you think is the main message? What?
Jesus cared enough to come back.
Jesus cared enough to come back? That's a good one. That's not the one I'm looking for. You can't ever argue with that. That Jesus cared, to come back. He kept his word and things like that. But what about this? Think about it in this way. What's the main message is, what happens? What happens to us when we try to do things without Jesus?
We're in trouble.
Or what ends up happening? Our nets end up being what? Empty, broken, and torn. But when we allow Jesus to not only be with us, but more importantly, to do what? They allow Jesus to do what that day, at that moment, that morning? They had been fishing all night on one side, and Jesus does what? He tells them to do what? Cast their net on the other side. Basically, he gives them what? Direction. When we do things with Jesus, but more importantly, when we follow his direction, when we do his will, what happens? Our nets are full. The nets will no longer be empty, but the nets will be full. And that's what I wanted to bring out in all of this, is that how many times do we try and go through life doing it without Jesus and not following his directions? And we always end up coming up with torn, empty nets in our life, right? If we simply start doing it with Jesus, following his direction, the nets of our life will be full and will be complete. And so that's why I wanted to look at all this. So we're going to stop here then tonight. And next week we're going to pick up and look at verses 15. And I'm praying that we'll be able to finish everything up. But we're going to look at that great story about, after breakfast, Jesus and Simon Peter are talking. And I want you to really try, I want you to go back and read this, especially look at first verses 15 through 19, and try and think, look at this in a completely different way. Don't look at it in the way you've always heard your entire life. Because we're going to look at this in some different ways next time we come together. So those of you at home, thank you for being here with us tonight. I hope you'll join us, not just next week as we finish up our Gospel of John, but also join us this Sunday, as we're back to worshiping together. So until we're together again, take care and God bless and goodbye.